No break, I gotta get paid.
Hey, this shit ain't cheap. Nigga, this shit ain't sweet. She mad, her nigga ain't me. He soft, that nigga ain't street. Who want beef? Got bread, got lettuce, got cheese. OGs only smoke OG. Fuck your blunt, that shit ain't weed. Yo, shit ain't hot, it's cold. That bitch ain't new, she old. That nigga ain't rich, he broke. Not feeling it, no. My shit ain't clean, it's dirty. She 30, she thirsty. Reversed it, she twerking. She perfect, ayy. This shit ain't cheap.
Hey, what's up, world? Thank you for tuning in. It's Copper Color Ty. Today's video, the death of the Bering Strait theory. I found this little article, and it seemed to be debunking the Bering Strait theory, and I wanted to go over it and elaborate on it. Let's get it. The death of the Bering Strait theory. Two new studies have finally put an end to the theory that the Americas were populated by ancient peoples who walked across the Bering Strait. Among scientists, this theory appears unshakable despite the lack of scientific evidence to support it. Indeed, a host of scientific evidence from linguistics to genetics does not support the theory. Imagine you are part of a small group of nomadic hunters, compelled for some unknown reason to leave your territory and drift to the northeast. Your journey may take decades to complete and might even continue long after your death. It began in the middle of a vast continent and involves moving towards a barren land of high mountain ranges marked by long, brutally cold winters. Hunting was a challenge in your former region, only it is much more difficult as your band heads deeper into the frigid north. Finally, years of deprivation and starvation, the scouts ahead of your group comes to the shore of a great salt sea, the other side of which is lost in heavy fog. Your band presses on, even as the few remaining animals disappear, and none among you has mastered the skills necessary to harvest food from the sea. Ahead of you unfolds a vast plain of treacherous bog across which no large mammal can pass. Since the marshy land lies stretched between two polar oceans, it is swept by hurricane force storms, which drive the temperature so low, skin turns to ice wherever it is in contact with the air. Superhuman effort is needed to endure the horrors of your journey, but the ever-dwindling band presses on, driven to the east by a strange compulsion which defies understanding. Most of your group dies of hunger on the bogs, but a few manage to stumble forward until they reach a new land, void of human habitation. Once again, there are unending mountain ranges to climb without any expectation the Arctic atmosphere will end. Finally, there is a glimmer of hope. Far ahead, you spot a bright band of blue and white shimmering in the distance. Perhaps these are low-lying clouds covering a sheltering valley where you might once again shed your heavy animal pelt cloaks and bask in the warm sun. As you get closer to the area, your spirits are crushed, for directly before the company is a treacherous glacier 2 miles high and stretching beyond sight from the north to the south. Some of your band want to return across the bogs, but others insist there is a way through the ice. As if by magic, they find a chasm in the glacier, which they eagerly enter and walk its entire 1,500-mile length without food of any kind, while contorting their frail bodies through a narrow wind tunnel marked by 200 miles per hour blast of frigid air. They emerge from the glacier to discover a fertile land of woolly mammoths, giant bison, and vast herds of horses, all of which migrated west. Your group is overjoyed by what they find and quickly populate the continent. Mysteriously, they ignore the smaller game creatures and risk their lives to exterminate the largest animals.
In time, your descendants will drift apart, and within an astonishingly short period developed over 500 languages and dialects to communicate across hundreds of nations spread over two continents. As strange as this may sound, it is the basis upon which many otherwise intelligent scientists have determined the Western Hemisphere was first populated by human beings. Anyone with a shred of common sense will come to the conclusion that Bering Strait migration theory is irrational. One of the great lies used to undermine our status as indigenous peoples. It is a theory lie, for no true physical evidence exists which supports this concept. It is a lie because the only time a land bridge connected Asia and the Americas together was during the Ice Age of 10,000 years ago, when human life in that region was impossible. Then there is the other serious problem with the Bering Strait theory. It collapses when archaeologists find evidence humans were here long before the end of the last ice age. Such evidence has been uncovered in South America, New Mexico, and California. But if Indians did not come from Asia, where are their origins? The school book story that most of us are used to doesn't seem to be supported. The new school book story is that the Indians migrated in boats down along the Pacific coast around 15,000 years ago. How long that theory will hold up remains to be seen. Now it's time to dig a little deeper into this article. So why did Native Americans have to leave their territory and head to the Northeast? Did another group of people compel them to leave their own territory? If so, who were these people and why was that their motive? Did Native Americans leave their territory because lack of food? Did they leave because of the environment was no longer sustainable for human life? Was there a huge war in Asia that lasted for many, many years, which caused the Native Americans to leave their own territory? If Native Americans originate from Asia, how come they are not classified as Asian American or Asian Native American? If Native Americans are the first to inhabit the Americas, why don't many Native Americans and archaeologists claim they are responsible for building the ancient mounds of the Americas? These are questions that need to be asked and answered. How did the elderly, also men, women, and children, survive the beginning of their journey after years of deprivation, starvation, and brutally cold winters? Remember, they never had superpower machinery, nor superhuman power, nor superhuman equipment to help them during this extremely freezing cold, deadly journey. This deadly journey required moving towards and through high mountain ranges with unbearable temperatures cold enough to freeze the human skin. What equipment did the Native Americans use to make it through these massive high mountain ranges? When they made it to the Salt Sea filled with fog, how did they survive when there were no animals left to be hunted? How did they survive when none of them mastered the skills necessary to harvest food from the sea? How did they make it past or make it through the vast treacherous plain of bog, which no large mammals could even pass? If superhuman effort was needed to complete this journey, how were Native Americans able to complete this journey with no superhuman effort at all? How were they able to make it through hurricane force storms with temperatures cold enough to turn the human skin into ice if the skin comes into contact with the freezing air? If most of the group died of starvation and died trying to make it past the marshy sinking bog, how did the small amount of Native Americans left manage to make it through? And what equipment did they use? How long did it take this small group of Native Americans to make it through this deadly sinking bog? How were they able to endure skin-freezing temperatures and hurricane-force storms? How did the elderly, how did the men, women, children, and babies climb and make it through these massive high mountain ranges, considering the harsh, deadly weather conditions they had to endure? When this small group of Native American spirits were crushed once they reached this 2-mile-high glacier, how did the elderly, how did the men, women, children, and babies managed to climb this 2-mile-high glacier with no modern-day climbing equipment on hand? What if there was a huge chasm that they could walk through? Keep in mind, They had no food. They did not have the skills necessary to harvest food from the ocean. Their bodies were frail, sick, and weak from this extremely long, deadly journey. How were they able to make it through this huge chasm with skin freezing air, blasting 200 miles per hour with no proper experience, clothing, and equipment needed? Metaphorically speaking, let's say they did make it through this 2-mile-high glacier stretching over 1,500 miles. If they were frail, sick, and weak when they arrived to the Americas, why would they risk their lives trying to exterminate the largest animals instead of hunting the smaller, easier animals? That doesn't make sense. When I was younger, I never thought about this, but how in the world can a small group of frail, sick, and weak Native Americans develop 500 different languages and dialects, populate 2 whole continents within a very short period of time, with no ancient or general knowledge of the land and the soil they migrated to? That makes no sense as well. 500 different languages and dialects is way more than a lot, and populating 2 whole continents within a short period of time? That's insane. One whole continent is massive. They are saying they populated 2 whole continents within a short period of time. Again, that makes no sense at all. If archaeologists have already found human remains in America that predate the arrival of the Native Americans, why don't they teach this in public education? Because they don't want us to know the race the human remains found in America really belongs to. It will expose who America really belongs to, which is not the modern day Native Americans. If they already uncovered human remains in 2 states in America and South America, what makes us think they have not uncovered human remains in the rest of the states as well, but refuse to tell us why? Why is this? Because there is a foreign agenda being promoted. The public education system was so certain the modern-day Native Americans arrived to the Americas through the Bering Strait. But now everyone is noticing the lack of scientific evidence supporting this theory. Now all of a sudden, they want to switch it up and say, oh, the Native Americans actually arrived to the Americas on boats along the coast about 15,000 years ago now. Well, the same questions still remain. Where are all the boats they used? What force did they use to manufacture these boats? What were their names of the boats? Who manufactured these boats? What did they use to repair these boats at sea? How often did they have to repair these boats at sea? How long did it take them to repair these boats? How long did the boat trip take to arrive from Asia to America? How many survivors were there? How many died along the way? How did they eat? What did they eat? Where did they sleep? What did they do with the human feces?
Pale-skinned natives came about as a result of the original dark-skinned natives breeding with pale-skinned Europeans. A light-skinned native born from this union would again breed with a pale-skinned European. Thus, the progeny of this union would become more pale or genetically recessive. After centuries of this breeding process, eventually produced the pale-skinned native of the Western Hemisphere. The dark, melanated-skinned natives who did not mix their seed still endured. The U.S. government has reclassified most as Black Americans or African Americans. The foreign U.S. government selected a certain psychological type of native, aka Indian, to promote to the world as this is a real Indian, as well as this is how a real Indian looks. The new group of hybrid people as Native Americans to the United States developed from children born from European females who procreated with melanated males, regardless of classification as American or Negro, as though females of America descended are not Americans. The European woman placed her genetically mixed half-breed children into the artificial category for the Americans as descendants to indigenous men of America called Native Americans, adopting indigenous names created by indigenous men supporting patriarchy. I'm not telling everyone to believe what I say. I'm telling everyone to think about and research what I say.